Okay, thank you very much. So here's my title. Okay, and I'm going to report on joint work with Ulrich Goertz. But before this, maybe I should apologize for the title. It's not a good thing to name the title after oneself. I have to say that I try to change this by describing what these spaces are, but then immediately people misinterpreted this, and then so I decided to go back to this. And it's actually not so necessary to know what these things are. Anyway, so I'll start with a local field, F. And I denote by F Breve the completion of its maxima and ramified extension in a fixed algebraic closure of F. And then the main object of this whole talk is the following set. So I'll first write it down and then explain the notation. So it depends on many things. It's the following set. So maybe in G Breve, mod K Breve, such that G inverse B sigma of G is in K Breve admissible set K Breve. Okay, so this is the main character of my talk, and the notation is the following. So by G, boldface G, I mean a reductive group, reductive algebraic group over the field F. And by G Breve, I just mean the rational points over F Breve. And by B, I mean a fixed element inside the set G Breve. And then K, this is a parahoric level structure. And from this, I deduce a parahoric subgroup K Breve. At least up to conjugation. So this is the K Breve that appears up there. So in other words, I'm looking at cosets of G Breve modulo K Breve. And sigma is the Frobenius. Maybe I should have said this in the beginning. By sigma, I denote the Frobenius of F Breve over F. And finally, there's the admissible set. So this is a finite subset of the Iwahori-Weil group, which is defined as follows. These are all elements in this group such that the following happens. So first of all, I forgot to say one more thing, namely, what is mu? Mu is a conjugacy class of homomorphisms of the multiplicative group of homomorphisms of the multiplicative group into G over F bar. Okay, and from Okay, so switch this back. For mu, the first thing I do is I construct an element which lies in the translation part of this Iwahori-Weil group, co-invariants under the Galois group of F. Breve. So these are the co-invariants. Under gamma zero, which is the Galois group of F bar modulo F Breve or unramified thing. Okay, so I don't want to explain how this is constructed, but in any case, it is it is well determined up to the conjugacy under the relative Weil group. So this is unique up to conjugacy under the finite Weil group. And now I can explain what this admissible set is. Yes, T is a maximal torus over F Breve, and I take the which defined over F Breve, I take the co-invariants under this Galois group acting, and this is this Iwahori-Weil group is an extension of this translation part. And the relative Weil group. Okay, and when I interpret this co-invariance as translations, I will actually use exponential notation. So I will say t to the element that is here. And so the admissible set are the sets of elements in W tilde such that this element W is smaller or equal under the Brüher order to a conjugate of this element mu bar for some x in W zero. Okay, so this is a definition. So if the group is split, then we don't have to take the co-invariance, and then we just are just talking here about the usual extended affine Weil group. So here we have the relative Weil group, and here we have the translation part. And so here, this is the picture. So I took, in this case, this is the case where G is equal to G of 3, and where the co-character is just 1, 0, 0. Okay, so the one of these two minuscule co-characters. This is here corresponding to the element of length zero. So this is here the base alcove. And then I take this this vector mu is this vector here. And so I take the translations by this element and its conjugates under the finite Weil group. So there is this one here, and this one here. And I translate by this element, so I get these three alcoves, and then I close it up with respect to the Brüher order, and so I get these additional three alcoves, in addition to, of course, to the base alcove that is always smaller or equal. Okay, so this is the admissible set in the simplest possible case.
You mean SN3?
Well, actually, I take G of 3 because the co-character, I want to use it at 1, 0, 0, in order to see this as a co-character, I better take GL3 or PGL3. It doesn't really matter. Okay, so this is a set that is the main character of my talk. And why is this interesting? Okay, so let me give the motivation. So I don't need the screen anymore for the time being. Great, thanks. Okay, so what is the motivation of this? Well, if F is a p-adic field, and the triple consisting of this algebraic group G, the conjugacy class of co-characters mu, and this element B, comes from what is called RZ data. So RZ data are essentially linear algebra data that describe this reductive group together with the co-character and this element B for U. And then this is what an RZ space is. Then one associates to this a formal scheme which is locally formally of finite type. Over the formal spectrum of the ring of integers in E breve. So E is the Shimura field, so in other words, the field of definition of the conjugacy class mu. Okay, so these are very interesting formal schemes, and if I take their set of points, so let's say I call this here M, G mu B, and K. If I take their points with values in the residue field of E breve, then I get exactly this set of points that I had defined before. Okay, and this is the reason that I'm interested in this set of points. So in this case, mu is a minuscule coweight. But I'm not making this assumption, I'm just talking about the set in general. But there is a problem with this. That's the Rapoport-Zink space. So it's a formal scheme. It's a formal scheme which is defined over the formal spectrum of the ring of integers of this unramified extension. Okay, so here's an example of how you get this. You take, let's say, the symplectic group, or the group of symplectic similitudes. Then, of course, you can describe this in terms of linear algebra, namely as a, by a vector space together with an alternating form. You look at you look at the corresponding moduli space, the Shimura variety, the corresponding moduli space of principally polarized abelian varieties. The reduced modulo p, and you take a fix and isogeny. This corresponds to fixing this element b, and then you take the formal completion of the Shimura variety along this locally closed subset of the special fiber. And then this is essentially the Rapoport-Zink space corresponding to these linear algebra data. Okay. Okay, this is the residue field of E breve, of O E breve. Okay, in all cases, this set has a structure of a scheme. So here, in this case of when we come from RZ data, of course, this is clear. But because this is the underlying reduced set of the formal scheme. But in general, this is a highly non-trivial statement. So in the function field case, so if F is in the function field case, then the set is a closed subset of a partial of an affine partial flag variety. And inherits from this a scheme structure. In the p-adic case, this is more complicated. Because there is some perfection going on. There's a perfection involved. So in other words, to define an algebraic structure of this, one has to go over to the perfection. So this is due. So in the function field case, this is due to Hartle and Feynman. Feynman. In the p-adic case, this is due to Butt and Schulze and Zhu. But in any case, in all cases, we can talk about irreducible components of this set. And we can talk about the dimension. So here are two examples. So the first example is a Lubin-Tate case. In this case, we take for G PGLN. We take for the conjugacy class the simplest minuscule co-character, 1, 0, 0, 0. And for B, we take the unique basic conjugacy class that is inside. So what this means is B is supposed to describe an isocrystal, and so we can give this by its Newton polygon, and the Newton polygon should just be a straight line. So here we have this core character, so let's say this is here 0 up to n, and then the mu is given, we can picture like this, and the Newton polygon should look like this. Okay, so in this case, the set is very easy. Namely, just a collection of endpoints. And this is true for all parahoric level structures. It's always endpoints. Okay, the second case is the Drienfeld case. Sorry, I have to use your name. Drienfeld case. Which is in some sense the opposite case. In this case, the group G is the algebraic group corresponding to the multiplicative group of the division algebra with invariant 1 over n over f. Again, we take the co-character 1, 0, 0, 0. And again, we take B, the basic conjugacy class. So in other words, the one, the Newton polygon that has no breaks. OK, so in this case, this RZ space M is a pi-adic formal scheme. And this set X mu BK, so there's only one K possible because this group is anisotropic, so K is here the Ivahoris level structure. In this case, there is no other level structure possible. And in this case, this is a equidimensional set dimension, a set of dimension n minus 1. So if n is equal to 2, this is the famous assemblyment of projective lines according to the Breuer-Titz tree of PGL2. And the goal of this project was to determine when does it happen that these two extremes are realized. So in the one case, we have the dimension is 0. In the other case, we have dimension n minus 1. And more precisely, Schulze asked me, can one characterize the Drienfeld case by simply asking the dimension of the underlying reduced set? Okay, so this is what this is all about. And so before I start with the answer, let me state a theorem which is due to Hill. Namely, this set XBK is non-empty if and only if the sigma conjugacy class of B lies in the set BG mu that was defined by Kottwitz. And what does this mean? This is the set defined by the Mazur inequalities. So we know the Mazur inequality says that the Newton polygon is always below the Hodge polygon. And so the group theoretic encoding of this condition is the subset BG mu of the set of all sigma conjugacy classes. Okay, and furthermore, the dimension of the set is small or equal to the number that we are used from the theory of Shimura varieties, namely the inner product of mu and 2 rho. And if equality holds, then B is the unique basic element in this set. In other words, it is a straight line that is defined in terms of this co-character mu.
Is this the letter rho? There is two something. Is it rho?
Rho. Mm-hmm. It's the usual half sum of all positive roots. Okay. So this is setting the stage. And now I want to give you the answers that we find. So let me start with the case of dimension 0. So this is minimal dimension. Okay, the first theorem is let B be basic. So maybe I should also say that from now on, I make the following blanket assumption. So blanket assumption is that G should be an adjoint group. It should be F simple. And finally, that mu is non-trivial. And of course, I also assume always that this thing is non-empty. So in other words, this is always in Kottwitz's set. I mean, these assumptions are all completely innocent. They don't make this thing more difficult or less difficult. Okay, so in the first part, I want to talk about minimal dimension. So let's start with the basic element B. Then the dimension of the set is equal to 0 if and only if this pair G mu is of extended Lubin Tate type. So what does this mean, extended Lubin Tate type? This means that G is of the form restriction of scalars from some finite extension F tilde of F of PGLN. And furthermore, there exists a place of F of F tilde over F such that the co-character, which is now after all given by a collection of co-characters of PGLN according to the embeddings of F tilde into F. So I want this to be equal to 1, 0, 0, 0 if phi is equal to phi 0 and trivial otherwise. So extended just refers to the fact that there is an extension of the field, ground field F involved. So what is remarkable here is that by making the assumption that the dimension is zero, we automatically get that the co-character mu is minuscule. And furthermore, this this condition that the dimension is zero is independent of the parahoric subgroup. Okay. So let me state another theorem, which in some sense complements this theorem. So for simplicity, I will now assume that G hat is absolutely simple. I mean, otherwise I would have to again write this in terms of restriction of scalars. It doesn't add any deeper sense to this. And again, assume that B is basic. And I exclude the extended, exclude the Lubin Tate case. For reasons that will become clear in a minute, namely, I look now at two parahoric subgroups, which are properly contained in one another, and I look at the transition morphism from the set for K into the set for K prime. And now I ask myself, when does this morphism have all fibers finite? Of course, in the Lubin Tate case, this is automatic because all sets and questions are finite. And so this is why I excluded the Lubin Tate case. And this is the case if and only if the following conditions are satisfied. So first of all, the group G is the adjoint group of a unitary group where V is a Hermitian space for some quadratic extension where F tilde over F is an unramified quadratic extension. And where the Hermitian space V is split. In other words, admits a Witt basis. and V is split. And secondly, the co-character mu is the usual one, 1, 0, 0, 0. And finally, this pair, K, K prime, satisfies the following condition. So I state this condition. This also, in some sense, illustrates what a parahoric subgroup is. Namely, so either the following case occurs. So we take K to be the stabilizer of a periodic self-dual lattice chain where the self-dual lattice occurs. And then we have lambda minus 1, lambda 1, which is the dual. And maybe it goes on. This is not important. Important is that 0, 1, and minus 1 are in this code, in this chain. And K prime, this is a stabilizer of the same lattice chain, except that you leave out the zero. And then you can do something. So this is one possibility. Or another possibility would be that n is equal to 2m. And then you can look at, instead of self-dual lattices, you can also look at lattices which are self-dual up to a scalar. So in other words, in this case, K can be the stabilizer of the guy, which is lambda m in the middle, and then I have lambda m plus 1 and lambda n minus 1. And then maybe further lattices. And K prime, I just leave out the Km.
You have lambda m.
Lambda m, sorry, lambda m. And finally, I can concatenate this. Okay, and in these cases, so in cases A and B, the fibers have one or two or q plus one elements. Q is the number of elements in the residue field of F. And then the case C, then you can just multiply. This is sort of speak in two independent things, so you can have one or two or four or two times q plus one and so on. Okay. Okay, I will comment on this theorem, I hope, in the end, when I will describe this in terms of linear algebra. This theorem is actually interesting in both directions. So here we saw in this theorem, this is only interesting in one direction, because for Lubin-Tate we know this. But in this, in the theorem two, the theorem is interesting in both directions. It's not obvious that in these cases the fibers are finite, and it's also not obvious that only in these cases the fibers are finite. Okay, so now let me switch to the case of a maximal dimension. And so we get the following theorem. If the dimension is maxima, in other words, is mu comma 2 rho, Then, first of all, B is basic. I already mentioned this. B is basic. Furthermore, the automorphism group of the corresponding isocrystal, so the sigma centralizer group, JB, is a quasi-split inner form of the starting group G. And this co-character that I was talking about, mu bar, this is minuscule. So I mean, if the group splits over F Breve, then this is the same thing as saying that mu is minuscule. So I mean, if G splits over F Breve, this means mu is minuscule. In general, it's a little, it is a little stronger. It implies that mu is minuscule, but is a little stronger. Okay, so here we have necessary conditions. And if K is the Iwahori subgroup, in other words, the minimal parahoric subgroup, then the converse holds. In general, there's a finite set of translations which I will call W of mu K finite and W tilde, which has a property such that, which has a property that the dimension is this maximum. Sorry. Mu 2 rho, if and only if this set is non-empty, and furthermore, W mu is non-empty, and this finite set parameterizes the orbits of the action of the rational points of the sigma centralizer group on the irreducible components of the set of maximal dimension. So in other words, the theorem tells you not only when the dimension is maximal, but it also gives you a picture of which irreducible or how many irreducible components realize this maximal dimension. These conditions, they seem somewhat mysterious. And so let me point out that, in fact, they are quite weak. So in other words, contrary to, I think, what Schulze thought originally, it happens quite often that the maximal dimension is achieved, like in Drienfeld's case. So if you start with any group, or any triple, G mu b, such that mu is minuscule, G should split over F Breve, and B is basic, then there always exists an inner form H of G such that the corresponding set for H, so you can use the same mu and the same B, and here you take the Iwahori subgroup, has dimension, oh, I say, is equal to mu and 2 rho. So in other words, it's very easy actually to produce elements, to produce examples where the dimension is maxima. So in some sense, this is a negative news. But the positive news is the following theorem. Let B be basic, then X mu BK is equidimensional of this maximal dimension. So in other words, I now exclude all components which have dimension if and only if the following occurs. So first of all, K has to be an Iwahori subgroup. And secondly, there are only three cases possible, namely restriction of scalars, I mean, so extended Drinfeld type, so restriction of scalars and then we have this co-character again corresponding to one embedding of this extension F tilde into F bar. Second case is, and this is very surprising, I didn't know about this case, restriction of scalars of the same thing, but now a quaternion algebra. But where the co-character sorry, wait a minute, what am I saying here? PGL2, sorry. This restriction of scalar of PGL2 of quaternion algebra. So in other words, this is a form of GL4. And in this case, we have the co-character 1100. I don't have an interpretation of this. And finally, the case is essentially the Hilbert Blumenthal case. So again, restriction of scalars of PGLN. And now the co-character is, so to speak, more complicated. So this, so maybe I have two embeddings now. Let's call them phi 0 and phi 1. Where this the core character mu at phi is now equal to the first fundamental core weight if phi is equal to phi zero, the last core weight n minus one if phi is equal to phi one, and trivial for phi not equal to phi zero or phi one. And furthermore, I have to make the assumption that if I look at the unramified extent, the maximal unramified extension in between f and f tilde, then these should not have the same restriction. So the most interesting case here is when f tilde over f is just a quadratic extension, an unramified quadratic extension. In this case, we are talking about the Hilbert-Blumenthal case. And this case actually was known to me for a very long time. It was actually my first PhD student, Stamm, who studied this case. And he discovered that in this case, so he studied the global situation, the Shimura variety, and he discovered that the special fiber has the same dimension, it's equidimensional, the same dimension as the generic fiber, even though there is no p-adic uniformization. Okay, and now if we look at this theorem here, we notice that there is a basic difference between these cases. Namely, so the first case, as I explained, this is the extended Drinfeld case. In this case, the only parabolic level structure is the Ivar-Hori level structure. But in the other two cases, you can also take other level structures, and then the dimension, then this corresponding set is not equidimensional anymore. And so we see, as a corollary, that if we modify Schulz's question by involving all parahoric subgroups, then the answer is positive. So corollary, x mu b k is equidimensional of dimension mu 2 rho for all parahoric subgroups, for all parahoric level structures, if and only if we are in the extended Drinfeld case. So in other words, in retrospective, Schulze was right. One can actually characterize the Drinfeld case in terms of dimension of the special fiber. And similarly, you can characterize those are these spaces which have p-adic uniformization. So of course, this is sort of difficult to formulate now, but let me just say that in our Z space, is pi-adic if and only if the RZ data are of extended Drinfeld type. I mean, there exists another characterization of the Drinfeld case, which is due to Kottwitz, there's a group theoretic description by him. Namely, it says that Drinfeld type means that the set B G mu has only one element, namely the basic element. The the motivation for this, it's, he doesn't say this in his paper, but the motivation for this is that, as I discovered, periodic uniformization of Shimura variety only holds if in the special fiber there's only one isogeny class. And so he translated this into the group theoretic condition that this set has only one element, and he asked himself, when does this actually happen? And he proved it only happens in the Drienfeld case. So in this sense, Kottwitz's characterization is a global characterization, whereas this one here is a purely local characterization of Drienfeld space. Okay, and so in the end, I have some time. So what about the proofs? So the proofs, as you can imagine, are largely combinatorial, and so it's very hard to explain combinatorics on the blackboard, I think. But there's one thing in this combinatorics which I think is remarkable, and this is a question that I asked 25 years ago, and this is answered by this paper. So let me give a definition. So I start with an element in this Iwahori-Weil group, and then a critical index for W is by definition a vertex in the apartment that lies in the intersection of the base alcove with its translate under W. Okay, and so here's the following theorem. So I assume for this that G is quasi-simple over F Breve. This is just to simplify things. Then every element of the admissible set has a non-empty critical index set if and only if this pair G mu is of extended Drienfeld type. So now I want to show another picture. Can we have the screen come down? I want to show another picture of a pair that is not of extended Drienfeld type, where you can see that there are elements which have critical index set empty. Okay, so first I have to switch this on. Is it on? Is it automatically on? Let me see, where's my other thing? Okay, so let me take the other one. Okay, so here we have the base alcove, and in this case, the mu is this element here, this vector here. And of course, it's conjugates under the finite Weil group, so there are these four vectors here, and we translate this, and we get these four alcoves, and then we've closed it up in the Brüer Brüer order. So we get this thick arrow. This is the admissible set. But now we ask ourselves, which of these alcoves have a non-empty intersection with this with the base alcove? And you see here, this is, I think here, these are the elements which have a non-empty intersection. For instance, this alcove here has a non-empty intersection, but this one here, it's in the admissible set, but it doesn't have a non-empty intersection with the base alcove. So this gives you an illustration that this property fails. Now, why is this property interesting? This is the basis of Greenfield's paper on periodic uniformization, the existence of a critical index for every element. And this has a, so Greenfield didn't state this in terms of the affine Weyl group. He stated this in terms of linear algebra. And so let me finish my talk by giving two expressions of linear algebra for these facts that I've been explaining. So first of all, the existence of a critical index. So what Greenfield's lemma shows says is the following. Let n, phi be an isocrystal. In other words, phi is a sigma linear operator acting on V, and we look at a periodic lattice chain. A complete periodic lattice chain. So we have L0 contained in L1 and so on up to Ln minus 1. And then we go into Ln, which is 1 over pi times L0. Okay, and I make the assumption that after applying phi to this lattice chain, I get another periodic lattice chain, that this is contained in this one with index 1. So I have here phi L1 and so on. And I make the assumption that this is contained always in this thing here, and all indices are equal to 1. Okay, and Greenfield's lemma says there exists I such that Li, there exists I such that, what am I doing? Sorry, no, there's a shift here, sorry. There's a shift here, L minus 1, L0, this goes up to Ln, this goes to N, N minus 2, N minus 1. Okay, there is a shift in this inclusion, and the statement is there exists I such that Li is equal to phi of Li. The lemma is very easy, because multiplication by p, if you look at the quotient, has to be 0, and it factors through a series of one-dimensional vector spaces. Therefore, one of these homomorphisms has to be equal to 0, and this translated gives this inclusion. So this is a very simple lemma, but it is the thing that makes the wheels go round. And now, to conclude, because I love linear algebra, let me also explain this finiteness of the fibers in theorem 2. So this is the following statement. I take an isocrystal phi together with an alternating bilinear form on it, with the usual with the usual condition. So this is a polarized isocrystal. I assume that all slopes are equal to 1/2. This is this assumption that I made that the thing should be basic. And then I have this unramified extension unramified quadratic extension f tilde of f acts on this vector space in such a way that this form is Hermitian. So in other words, if I move it from the first entry to the second entry, I have to apply conjugation. Okay, and I again consider a periodic lattice chain. Let's assume maximal if you want, which is self-dual. So in other words, I get L minus 1, L 0, L 1, and so on. And this time, I make the assumption that phi of L minus 1 is contained in L minus 1 and contains pi times L minus 1, and so on for the others as well. Okay, and now in this case, this condition that the index be equal to 1 is going to be replaced. Namely, if you look at these quotients, I have the action of the ring of integers of f tilde over f, or I should say that, and there should also be OF tilde stable. So I get an action of this extension, and therefore I get, in fact, not only an index consisting of one number, but an index consisting of two numbers. And I want this index here in the lower half to be always n minus 1, 1, and then the upper half 1, n minus 1. Okay, so in this case, theorem 2, one direction, says the following. Under these conditions, there are only finitely many possibilities of filling in this L0 in the middle when I fix the other ones. So only finitely many. Ways of filling in. L0, which is quite surprising, and it never, as the theorem also says, that it never occurs again in any of these cases that you can think of. Okay, I think I'm done. Thanks.